tonight, is forgiveness overrated?
I don't think I'll ever forgive her.
Along the way, I chose to let go.
For a long time, I didn't think that I needed anybody to apologise to me or say sorry.
Is holding on to the past hurting you?
I think most people find that the anger becomes dysfunctional.
You will not be stuck in hatred and vengeance. Righteous anger doesn't kill anybody.
But what about forgiving yourself?
Oh, it's terrible. It's one of the lowest times of my life, being responsible for something like that.
I should have seen it. And I didn't.
Hi, I'm Jenny Brockie. Welcome, everybody. Good to have you all here. Linda, who is it that you can't forgive?
My husband and my sister-in-law.
And why is that?
Because they had a 17-year affair and it was revealed, and I can't ever forgive the fact that they were sleeping together all that time.
So this was your husband?
Yep.
And your brother's wife?
Yeah.
Did other people know what was going on?
Afterwards, I found out, yes, a lot of people did know what was going on.
And how did you feel about that? You had no inkling?
I did, on and off, over many periods of time, but I was always convinced by him that, no, darling, I wouldn't do that to you, and I chose to believe him.
So when you found out, how long ago did you find out?
Nearly 2 years ago.
So not that long ago?
No.
And how did that affect you when you found
out? Oh, bad.
I
had a breakdown. I spent a lot of time with a psychologist and on antidepressants and trying to find out who I was and work my way through it and find some sort of worth to go on. But, yeah, now I'm starting to come out the other side.
And your brother?
My brother's still not coping with it. Even though she had left him 2 years prior to me finding out and he has since remarried, he still doesn't cope with it.
Can you imagine ever forgiving your ex-husband?
Never.
You're very sure about that?
I'm positive.
Why do you feel so sure about that?
If I was to forgive him, I would be saying, it's OK what you did, and I will never think that that's OK.
You don't think it might be good for you to forgive?
No, because I'm happy. I'm happy now I know the truth, and I'm happy now I've moved on.
John, there's someone you can't forgive either. Tell us why, who that is and why.
My 15-year-old daughter was murdered by a young girl, and I came home and found my daughter. It was especially difficult for everyone in the family, but for me, I was supposed to be looking after her. And I guess I failed pretty dismally.
Well, why do you take that on yourself? Why do you think it was your failure?
I'd only been asked to look after her for a month or so by myself. Up until then, my wife had always been there to look after her, and Kaz had gone on a holiday that she really wanted to go on. And it seemed like a fairly simple task to look after one 15-year-old kid.
Now, this girl was... your daughter was going out with this girl's former boyfriend, is that right?
For about 3 days.
Yeah, so it was jealous. It was driven by jealousy?
The presentation in the court was that it was driven by jealousy. There's only one side of the story that can be told in a court on a murder charge, because the other person isn't there.
How do you feel about your daughter's killer?
I don't think I'll ever forgive her. I have tried to find a word that I can use, and forgive is definitely not it. I don't know whether it's good for me or bad for me or what, but I carry this anger with me, and it's directed at her. She's the cause of many of my problems, and it's not necessarily all her fault, but when your brain gets a bit scrambled up, you tend to not work too well, not function all that well, and I haven't functioned too well for a while.
Mm. Karen, you've had a very different experience to your husband in terms of forgiveness. Can you explain that to us?
Well, to me, forgiveness, it's a loaded word. It's quite a difficult word, and to me it has religious overtones, and it actually puts a lot of pressure on people. For me, forgiveness is a journey, and it's a process that's ongoing, and it's not something that, for me, happened instantly. It was, at first, when you're in shock and you're going through the trial and all those things, and you're grieving as well. So you're going through the stages of grief, and part of that is anger and denial and all those things. Forgiveness didn't come into it in the early days at all. I've never hated the girl who killed Jess, but I've felt lots of anger and I felt lots of resentment. And I still sometimes do. But along the way, I chose to let go. For me, forgiveness is letting go. It's letting go of all the negative emotions that keep you bound to that, to the other person, the person who's harmed you. And I've gradually, through doing restorative, the Sycamore Tree Project, and through doing a lot of personal work and
that's a restorative justice project.
Restorative justice program. And just gradually, over the 14 years, I've been able to release a lot of those negative emotions, and now I can say that I've let go. I don't need to see this young girl. Well, she's not a young girl anymore, but I don't need to see her punished anymore. I think she's been punished enough. It doesn't mean that I condone what she did. It means that I've accepted what has happened, and I don't have the need to see her punished anymore.
So as a married couple, how do you two deal with these differences over something so huge in your
life? There are many things that overlap here, though. I too went to the Sycamore Tree, to the restorative justice, and also gained a fair bit out of it. But along the way, I decided that what I was doing wasn't really helping me. It might have been helping others, but it wasn't helping me. As far as the wanting to inflict more pain on the girl who did this, I'm quite happy for her to be released if the system decides that she should be released. I'm not after vengeance or anything like that. I don't hold her forever responsible to the point where she has her life totally destroyed or anything like that. I just cannot, in my heart of hearts, say I forgive her. And that's all it comes down to. It's that one word.
I think a lot of people wouldn't expect forgiveness in that situation. Mm. Yeah? Maybe? I don't know. What do people think about that?
Well, I speak as a Christian theologian, but I also speak as a person who's had a lot of experience in this. I was principal of a college in Indonesia, training clergy, and during the violence between Muslims and Christians, where they murdered each other, six of my students who had been ordained as clergy were killed, some of them publicly beheaded. So I faced the issue of forgiveness. The Christian view, of course, is that we begin by understanding that we are a loved people, that all the human race are loved by God, and in a sense they are forgiven. Now, that doesn't mean that we have a cheap understanding of life. We can just shrug it off. Of course there's pain. Of course it's very, very hard to get to the end of the road of forgiveness. But Christianity says you need to see yourselves as people who have been forgiven by God and start on the journey. Not simply because you do it for your own sake, but because that's the way the world is.
Mark, I want to talk to you. Nearly 4 years ago, you went to jail. Tell us why.
I was driving the car that caused Tao to become paraplegic in a car accident. I was under the influence of alcohol. So
tell us what happened.
We went out fishing and had a big night on the night drinking, and coming home, we lost control of the vehicle and rolled several times, and that was the outcome of the accident.
Had you both been drinking? Were you?
Both been drinking together.
Mm. And Teo, that accident left you in a wheelchair. When did you realise what had happened, the extent of what had happened to you?
I woke up in hospital after being in the coma for a bit over a week or so. And then, I sort of had a bit of brain damage also. And I slowly worked it out myself, so I'd say about 2 to 3 weeks after the accident.
Right, so you worked out yourself what had happened.
Yeah, I was laying there and couldn't feel my legs and realised I was in hospital, so 2 and 2 together, pretty much.
And, Mark, when did you find out what had happened?
About 2 weeks after, when they sort of, everything had settled down and the swelling had gone and, the doctors were clear that was the injuries that we were notified.
How did you feel about that when you heard?
Oh, it was terrible. There's too many ways to describe it, really. Like, it was just one of the lowest times of my life, being responsible for something like that.
Hmm. And Teo, how did you feel about the situation and about Mark, given that he'd been the person driving the car?
Well, because I bashed my head, I didn't know what actually happened. Then when I come to, I sort of got told what happened. Then first thought was, is Mark okay? Like, he wasn't around when I woke up. And then, my main worry is Mark, as long as he was okay.
Your main concern was him?
Yeah. My best mate.
He's your best mate?
Yeah. It was an accident.
Yeah. Tell us about the extent of your injuries. What is life like for you day to day now?
Oh, it's pretty slow and boring. Can't get out and do the things I used to do by myself. So I need hand to. It's like my main passion's fishing. I can't take my boat out by myself anymore. I need someone to come and launch the boat for me and chuck me in it. And also work. I can't work in my trade anymore. I was a builder, but can't do that anymore. So I've got to find another job, but it's a bit hard at the moment to find work.
Did you ever feel resentful towards your mate?
Never.
Never ever?
It was both our ideas to get into that car. Like, I knew what, we knew the risk we were taking. Like.
So you shared the responsibility for what had happened?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. Well, I'm the fisherman. Mark's not even a fisherman, so if anything, I should be asking for his forgiveness because we ended up fishing.
Does forgiveness come into it for you?
We're just two idiots that, I don't know, we've done it one too many times and come unstuck.
Hmm. What about you, Mark? Is forgiveness an issue for you in all of this?
Yeah, definitely. Like, it's forgiveness of myself. Like, I'll, no matter what happens, no matter what Taya says to me, I just can never forgive myself for what happened. Like, because to me, forgiveness is forgetting. And, for me to forget what happened that night and that morning, I sort of think I'd lose track of what happened, and it's not such a bad thing to sort of never forget what happened because it keeps me on a straight line, and to me it's it's just something that I've accepted responsibility for, and I just it'd be silly and selfish of me to forgive myself, I think.
Forgiveness doesn't have to mean forgetting, though.
But to me, that's what I believe.
That's how you feel
about
it.
Yeah, that's how I feel, yeah. I think forgiveness is forgetting. And,
and Teo, how do you feel when you hear him say that?
It's hard to explain, really. Like, we both dealt with it our own ways. And
it's not like, it's not something I expect Teo to understand, because if it was up to Teo, I'm sure he'd say, forgive yourself, forget about it. But it's not.
That's, get over it, sister.
But that's not the way that it is. To me, that's my own way of dealing with the whole situation. That's something that I keep close to myself. And
so that's part of you taking responsibility.
To me,
for what happened?
It's just something that, for the rest of my life, will help me with the decisions that I make, I believe.
Hmm. Losh, you're Teo's mum. What do you make of the way the boys have dealt with this, and how did you deal with it as a mum?
Forgiveness never sort of came into my mind, really. I suppose I was angry with both of them for getting in the car in that state, and they've done that and they've changed a lot of lives for a long, long time. But they deal with it in their own ways. And
how did you deal with it?
Up and down, yeah.
Did you feel angry towards Mark?
No, not
as the driver of the car?
No, not towards Mark, to both of them, because they both were silly and they both got in that car after drinking and a long night.
How did they... I'm going to ask you how you think they dealt with it.
They've both dealt with it, I think, pretty badly with alcohol, drinking, binge drinking, and many a night I've worried myself sick about them both, especially Tao not knowing if he was going to be safe. So, yeah.
Would the reaction be the same if they'd harmed an innocent third party?
It would be. I think it's the anger again, but it's not my place to forgive them. It would be that person's place to forgive them.
Because my experience, my father was an innocent victim killed by a drink driver. So for me, forgiveness is not the word forgiveness. It's not allowing that event to make me bitter and twisted. You know, I've got a life, I've got a family. Mm. Yeah, you know, I want to be present for them, not, you know, consumed with rage towards this person. So
is that about forgiveness, or is that about something else?
I guess it is
else?
About forgiveness, yeah.
Mm.
But I'm not doing it for their benefit, I'm doing it for my benefit.
Yeah. I'm interested in what some of our psychologists here think about this. Jeannie, in New York, you're a psychologist, and I wonder what you think listening to these stories and how you see forgiveness, how you define it.
Well, one of the things I see is that everybody has a different notion of forgiveness. One man's or woman's forgiveness is another's non-forgiveness. It's really extraordinary how subjective this is. And we all come into this thinking forgiveness is what it says in the dictionary. And it really isn't. It's amazing. The same event can be seen as forgiven or not forgiven, depending on who it is. I think what's really striking to me is that some people have an agenda in advance to forgive, usually a religious agenda or a psychological agenda that's based on a religious agenda. And others have an agenda of trying to understand and work through. Whether that leads to forgiveness or not is really not known in advance, and that really is my position. You don't know in advance, and there's no one-size-fits-all solution. I'm also struck by the fact that particularly the man who said he couldn't forgive himself, that was a very striking thing, because although I don't believe that you should forgive everything, I've always said that you should, the one person you have to live with is yourself. And I think that for him, the real thing that's a problem for him is that he has to find an explanation. He has to find a logic. The fact that this woman did this thing to his girl, it tortures him, and he can't accept the unfairness and the illogic of the act, the fact that he is helpless in the face of it. And therefore, he would rather turn against himself than to say the universe sometimes doesn't make sense. That's a preliminary assessment from me.
Okay, John, what's your response to that? That maybe an alternative is to just think the universe doesn't make sense. Terrible things happen. It's not my fault.
I spent 18 months with a psychologist before I walked into the court. And believe me, if you think I'm off my head now, you should have seen me before she got hold of me. I don't think people understand how much this goes with you everywhere. How much you run, you hide, you do all sorts of things, you try different things. I hate my wife. She does things and they work. And I do the same things, I get involved in the same things, and I just struggle.
But you're two separate people. What I'm really interested in is that your relationship is obviously still very strong despite going through this.
Oh, I'm scared of her.
But I'm interested in the fact that you both dealt with it so differently and yet you're able to hang together.
We have been extremely lucky because we haven't lost our sense of humour. And that's the whole family.
That's remarkable. remarkable achievement. And you should recognize how far you've come if you can laugh at anything after such a devastation.
But it's also the love and respect. I love my husband very deeply, and I respect him, and I respect that that's his journey, and he has to go down his own path. And we've both always allowed each other that. Everybody's path is different.
I think it's terrific that you're not lobbying him to take the same path that you did. That's very important, because one of the things that's very difficult for a person is to be told there's something wrong with you for not doing what I'm doing, for not having a forgiving heart or whatever it happens to be.
Alfred, you have studied forgiveness. Is it something to always aspire to? Or are there situations where it's just perfectly fine not to forgive?
I've got to walk you through the process. And it really starts with our research participants say, I first need to empower myself. I need to get my brain ready, right. I need to get my emotions right. And then I've got to forgive myself. Forgiving self is internal. It's letting go. Letting go of your anger. You do it for yourself. And then, if you want to move on, you may then start developing more positive feelings about the other person. And at that stage, you may develop what's called sometimes as the interpersonal aspect of forgiving. So let's talk about interpersonal forgiving. And then there's another stage, and that is reconciliation, where you really trust the person to such a degree that the relationship is maybe better than it used to be. Now, I don't think, to get back to your question, everybody should forgive. I think it's a very personal thing. I think people know when they're ready. I agree that it can take many, many years. Everybody says that. And I think a person will just know how they move through it and what's right for them. I know some people who have not forgiven, and they use that very constructively to do work as activists and so forth.
What, to use that anger?
Yep.
Yeah? So you think that anger can be harnessed in a positive way?
Some people seem to be able to do it. I think most people find that the anger becomes dysfunctional and it's not good for their health and their relationships and so forth. But I think there are exceptions to the rule, and I'll never tell anybody you've got to forgive.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask you. What do you say to people?
I won't tell anybody you've got to forgive.
James, do you tell people they have to forgive?
Well, it depends how you define forgiveness. This is the question that's been raised. I don't think you should ever forget, and the Christian tradition doesn't believe in forgetting, because the forgetting reminds us of who we are. But we need to realise that we are people who are loved and forgiven by God, and we should begin the steps.
John, you've said that in some ways you feel protected holding on to your anger. Can you explain that for us?
I not only protect myself, because it defines a lot of what happened. Jess's memory is always there. So I will never forget. I will never forget her, because I will never forget the pain that goes with her passing. So in lots of ways, the system that I've set up inside my head and that I live with reminds me constantly of my daughter, reminds me constantly of what happened, puts me in reality. Otherwise, I think I would go mad.
So you fear forgetting her?
I fear... Sorry. I feel the world forgetting her.
So you're hanging on to that by staying angry? Yeah.
So righteous indignation.
You call it what you want to.
We don't want to go into a therapy session here, Jeannie, I don't think. But I'm interested in you I'm interested in you commenting generally here rather than specifically about John's situation or anyone else's.
Okay.
I just wanted to ask you something about this idea of of whether forgiveness is the thing that everyone should aspire to. What do you think of that idea?
I absolutely disagree. I think it's a subjective thing. A lot of it has to do with definition, and a lot of it has to do with personality. Some people don't have that agenda. They have the agenda of understanding, of working through, of grieving. Forgiveness is a religious concept. And what about a person who doesn't have religious belief or who has questions? The first thing to do is to try to understand what happened, how you feel, to try to understand what was going on with the other person. Then, to me, the anger abates naturally. You don't have to make it happen. You don't have to engineer forgiveness.
Then he'd say, oh, I'm sorry, you know, I did talk to her. And
yeah, that's not an apology.
Yeah, a bunch of flowers.
Have there been apologies between you two?
Yeah, I send you flowers all the time.
Tonight we're talking about forgiveness. Linda, how do you think you're perceived by people as someone who won't forgive, who doesn't want to forgive?
I think a lot of people understand why I won't, because to me it just means that I think that it was all okay and it never will be.
Do you ever get people who think you should?
No, not really.
And what's at the heart of your unwillingness to forgive, do you think, at the very heart of it? Is it just what happened or is it something else?
It's the whole betrayal. It was the whole believing in these people, loving this man so much all my life and thinking that, no, he's just betrayed me the whole time. And that, I don't think I could ever forgive that. It hurt me so much. So, and it tore apart my family.
Hmm. Can you forgive other things?
Yes.
People, other things, like other big things?
Yes, as long as they tell me the truth. As long as it's not a lie.
Mm-hmm. Jeannie, you're agreeing there, and I know you've got your own experience of betrayal.
I certainly do. I came to this topic from the inside. When I was 16 years old, I came back to my parents' house and found my father in flagrante with two women, neither of which was my mother. My father was a physician. I was his adored child. He pretended it didn't happen. He insisted I was wrong. It was quite a devastating experience. And because of that, when he died, when I was in my early 30s, I didn't go and see him before he died. And one of the reasons that I've written about forgiveness is I really thought that I had to understand what went on between him and me, who he was, what this was all about, and I began to grieve for the fact that I couldn't support him at the end because there were many wonderful things about him too. And I ended up forgiving him and forgiving myself, which was a very, very important thing. And it really has transformed my relationship with him. I really regained my relationship with him. So I'm not against forgiveness.
Mm. Jeannie, I'm interested. Well, you talked about, in your own situation, you talked about forgiving your father, but was that after he died?
Oh, yes. I believe that posthumous forgiveness is sometimes much easier because you have more of a perspective on the person. Also, when I went through this, I was 16. When I worked it through, I was a middle-aged woman, and I understood much more about how a middle-aged man might feel than I did when I was a 16-year-old girl. So I think time is on your side when it comes to resolution.
Would it have made a difference to you if at some point he had apologized to you?
I've thought about that. I'm not sure. I think it would have made a difference if he had recognized not only what he had done, but the effect that it had on me.
Linda, did your husband apologize to you?
Yeah. He'd say, oh, I'm sorry, you know, I did talk to her and... But it was never anything else, and I'd forgive and...
But that's not an apology, because
a lot
more was going on.
Yeah, always the same thing. And then the last time, after he actually admitted it to me, I got the same, I'm sorry, and bunch of flowers, and, that wasn't pretty.
Oh, great.
You're saying they didn't work?
No, it didn't work this time.
Have there been apologies between you two?
Yeah, I send you flowers all the time. I don't know, there's
nothing to apologise for.
Not really. I'm just grateful Taylor thinks of it like that.
Did you ever feel the need to apologise, Mark, or not?
To Taylor?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, yeah, because, obviously I was the one driving. Mm. It was my car, but, of course I'd apologise because, I took a lot of responsibility because I was driving, so...
Alfred, how much is an apology a prerequisite for forgiveness, do you think?
It can make a huge difference. And I think it's important to understand that as forgiveness is subjective, an apology, the receiver of an apology also can sometimes... What we talk about is whether it's a good enough apology. And what would be a good enough apology in one situation may not be good enough in another situation. And what may be good enough for one person may not be good enough for another person.
I wonder, though, whether you can have forgiveness without an apology. I mean, if somebody holds fast to something they've done that's unjust, unfair, wrong, can you forgive without that person acknowledging that they've done wrong?
You can, in the sense of internally and letting go and moving on, because otherwise you allow that person to keep you prisoner.
I don't think you have to forgive to be out of prison, because understanding and resolution can contain some anger still. You don't. Forgiveness is a Christian concept, essentially, and many people don't think in those terms. If I'm able to go on with my life, as Linda has, if I'm able to love other people and forgive other people, why must I forgive?
Let's have a look at a very public prime ministerial apology.
As Prime Minister of Australia, I am sorry. On behalf of the Government of Australia, I am sorry. On behalf of the Parliament of Australia, I am sorry. And I offer you this apology without qualification.
Susan, you were the executive producer of that TV broadcast, and you're also a member of the Stolen Generation. I wonder how that apology to the Stolen Generation affected you.
It affected me like I didn't think it would. For a long time, I had done a lot of the journeying, as Karen put it, and came to a place of peace inside of myself. And for a long time, I didn't think that I needed anybody to apologise to me or say sorry in relation to being taken away. When I was working on that program and I read the motion the day before, I totally broke down. And it really shocked me. And I didn't, on an emotional
Why
level...
Why did it shock you?
Because I didn't think I needed an apology. And
what, you thought you'd worked through your own situation?
Yeah, I had worked through my own emotion and got myself to a place where I was at peace with my life, and that I could live my life, I could love, and I, you know, could carry on and function. Mm-hmm. And with a former Prime Minister who refused to apologise, I was resigned to that. And I think that a lot of people from the Stolen Generation were resigned to that. So I'd gotten to a place where I didn't think I needed to hear the words "I'm sorry" in relation to being taken away, because I'd done the work internally. When I read the motion, that's when it was an opening of floodgates, and we got to see that outpouring of emotion the next day when the Prime Minister spoke those words, and it shocked me.
So does forgiveness come into it for you? Is what do you make of this word, forgiveness?
It's a word. For me, it's around the work that an individual does for themselves in around any given situation. So for me, it's just a word. And I kind of, you know, I do respond to it in a certain way, and I do agree with Karen. It's very loaded, and there is a perception of how we're meant to behave and function when things happen to us.
Do you think it's okay to not forgive?
Absolutely. And I think that's someone's personal right.
And where do you think that leaves people? I mean, there is this kind of expectation
that we have to forgive
and that you're going to be better if you forgive than you are if you don't.
Right. I think people, in whatever given situation that they're in the emotional state that they're in at that time, is perfect for them. And if they don't want to forgive, that's okay.
Alfred, what about if an apology is insincere or forced in some way?
It depends on whether the recipient thinks it's forced or insincere. We've done some research with people who've actually, where there's been apology was compelled, and they would say things like, I knew it wasn't sincere, but for me in this at this point in time, it was still worthwhile. Mm.
Karen and John, I wanted to talk to you about visiting your daughter's killer in jail, which you did a few years ago, many years after the event. I wonder, what was that like for you and why did you do it?
Well, for me, it was part of the journey of healing. I wanted to actually talk to Kelly. I wanted to get a sense of who she was, because when you go through the justice system, you're very much left on the outside. You don't have any opportunity to connect with the person who has perpetrated the crime. And I needed to face her and talk to her and tell her certain things that I didn't have the opportunity to do before. So for me, it was part of my healing journey, and I'm really pleased that I did it, and I really hope that that she got something out of it.
And John, what about you?
You were talking about apologies before. I think the best way to qualify an apology that isn't really all that valuable is when it's asked for. Do you want one? Mm. I don't want an apology. I don't believe an apology is even remotely useful.
Mm. Because of the magnitude of what happened.
An apology sounds like you've put a Band-Aid over a small problem.
But can I just take you back to the experience of meeting this woman? What was that like for you compared to what it was like for
Karen? Terrifying. Absolutely terrifying. My biggest fear was that I went to see Kelly first and there was a two-day delay before Kaz went. If I stepped over the line or did anything or upset anybody or said anything wrong, Kaz would never get her opportunity. So there was a degree of you must be on your best behaviour about the whole thing. And I really desperately wanted to see her before she was released. And I was convinced that she was going to be released after the 11-year term, minimum term was up. And I thought, how do I react if I'm walking through the local shopping centre and I meet her? And I... Hmm. It's a biggie. You know, you don't know how you're going to react. You don't know whether you're going to turn
out... So you wanted to prepare yourself,
yes,
in a way.
Yes, in some way. So I actually started the process to go and see Kelly in the prison. And I'm glad I did it. I think it was beneficial to me. I don't know whether it was beneficial to her. I have no idea. But it was beneficial to me in so much as I've seen a human instead of a monster.
I'm just wondering whether you would have done things differently if you hadn't had that be on my best behaviour because you wanted your wife to have the same opportunity.
There was more than one occasion where I could easily have turned it into an argument. And I didn't. I chose to step back from it.
Do you still want to have that argument with her?
Probably. But I don't think it's necessarily good for either party.
So you wanted more truth from her?
I didn't want an apology. I wanted her to say, I did this and this is what I did. That, to me, is an apology. Not, I'm sorry.
You mentioned that she wasn't the monster you expected her to be, but were there other things that surprised you in that process?
It's a harrowing experience. It's not something that you do for the hell of it. And with my background of anger, all it served to do to a large extent was stir me up considerably. I got some good things out of it, but I got a lot of bad things too.
Karen, you've said that you felt under pressure to not forgive, in a sense. Can you explain that, what that pressure was?
Well, in the victim community, in a way, even for myself,
I wondered whether if I let go of the rage, if I let go of and forgave, would I be betraying Jess? So I struggled with that for a while internally. There is also an expectation amongst a lot of victims of crime, especially when it comes to the top end, the serious, you know, homicide, that somehow by that you're betraying your loved one if you do let go. By maintaining that that anger, then that's honouring them. And I have had a lot of people say to me, well, how can you possibly forgive? You know, as if I'm condoning. And it's not about condoning what happened.
Lynn, your Karen's sister, what do you make of all of what this family has been through and what you've been through too, presumably?
I'm just very proud of them at the moment. Yeah, look, it's been a long journey for all of us and...
How do you feel about the idea of forgiveness?
I don't have any anger towards Kelly and I just hope she is rehabilitated. I can't say I forgive what happened. I've accepted that it's happened because we can't change that. And we learn to live with this every day and we've all, you know, gone through different levels of grief and trauma. But I think, you know, the one thing that's come out of it, I think, is, you know, just the strength of our family. It's just, we are very close and we're very strong and we talk about it and it's not a subject that is hidden. And, you know, we're all on this together and, yeah.
Karen, you talked about being under pressure not to forgive. Tao, I wonder whether you've been under any pressure around your relationship with Mark. Did people expect you to feel differently to the way that you felt?
Yeah, I've had people ask me, like, how are you still mates? Like, and I've got certain friends that, like, refuse to, like, meet Mark. And like, I just tell them to pull their head in and get over it. Like, we've gotten over it. Like, they don't know our friendship and what we've been through.
That must be very hard for you, Mark, yes, when you've got this strong relationship, obviously.
It is hard. That's hard. Like, it is hard to accept, but at the end of the day, everyone's entitled to their opinion and, like, I can understand people have been through things that are obviously different situations to what we've been through and they've ended up, a lot different, but in our situation and what we've been through, to me, all that matters is that we're fine, like, we're together.
We've done it together.
Yeah. We're still mates. What everyone else from the outside thinks about us, you know, I can't change that. Like, I'll just keep doing what I'm doing and being mates with Tao, well, that's just my main concern.
John, what next for you? What are you hoping for in terms of yourself?
I still don't believe that I've got the truth and it drives me mad that I don't really know what happened.
Tonight we're talking about forgiveness and whether it's always appropriate. Mohammed, you've lived through civil wars in Liberia. What do you think is the key to forgiveness, having come from a place where there's been civil war?
It's a process. And that process is about, first of all, like someone said before, empowering yourself first. Get to help yourself, put yourself together, and begin the process of understanding another person's point of view.
Even if there are atrocities involved, even if really terrible things have happened, how do you get to a point where you can understand the other point of view?
Where you get to a point you can understand the other person, with that, I would say, depends on the context, the situation. There was a point I felt I was a victim and I belonged to a group. Another time, I was considered a perpetrator. By another person who are considered...
Well, it all depends which side you're on.
Yes, all depends on which side you are. And so in that way, it was so easy for me because my whole story started in 1991. 1991, we were hiding in a bush in Liberia, the part of Liberia that was in control of the army that was targeting my people. So all of a sudden, we saw one member of my tribe that came up from the bush and just fell in front of us. And we asking him, why? What is this about? He said, I've just survived, ran away from people who captured me. They wanted to kill me, and I ran away from them. That's the first time it hit me. I said, wow, this could be me. This is a reality. That's the first time I felt hit. Then the next action from them was to see how to understand the people who were looking for us, who were targeting us. The more I begin to listen to their story, the more it reduced the tension in me.
How have other people in your community reacted to your reaction to this? Like, how do they feel about your approach to the Civil War? Do they agree with it, or do they not think it's the right way to
There are lots of people who disagree with me. Like what Karen said, there are a lot of pressure to say, there's this notion that you are surrendering, you are naive, you don't really understand what is going on. But in reality, I see them that they've been subjugated, they are still enslaved, and they're going through pain. I feel empowered.
So how did you get to that point? What do you think sets you apart from the people who can't think like that? How did you get there?
It's my effort to understand the other person's point of view.
OK, yeah. A lot of nodding from you, James.
Well, I very much agree with that. I mean, I agree that forgiveness is a religious concept, but the beginning, I think, is never totally forgetting what happened, but truth-telling.
Alfred, what about... You talk about pseudo-forgiveness. What is that?
Yeah, probably a better word is hollow forgiveness, is where somebody tells somebody, I forgave you, but they haven't done this internal work. So it's really just a front. And that's often because they feel they've got to. And I think that's what Linda is making very clear to us, is she's congruent. She's not done that. Maybe she's done that work, but at least she's very honest. Can I just say something about Linda's case as well? I think you asked me earlier, when is it not good to forgive? And one place where it's not good to forgive, if it's when you're being manipulated by somebody or when you're being abused by somebody. And we see this cycle.
The cycle, yeah.
Yes.
And where someone apologises,
that's right,
and the person accepts the apology, yes, and the cycle of abuse goes on. Yeah. Yeah. James, I just wonder whether there's a danger in putting forgiveness on a pedestal.
Yep.
That people feel compelled to forgive when they really don't, that there is a sense of pseudo-forgiveness that might exist because of that pressure.
I mean, I agree, it's a religious term. I see it more as a process where you begin to go that way, and very much at the heart of it is what I would call tough truth-telling, trying really with immense pain to get the truth out. Then there can be an apology, which one hope avoids the hollow apology that Alfred's talked about. So it's a genuine apology if one can be achieved, and there may be forgiveness. But it's a long process. It means a lot of things to a lot of people, and from my experience, the most important thing is this truth-telling, this painful process of truth-telling.
We are going to have to wrap up. Jeannie, just very quickly, you talk about healthy unforgiveness, but what about all the research, yes, that says your health improves if you forgive and let go of anger?
Nobody does any research on whether you simply reach a point of neutrality, whether that's good for your health. I think when you resolve something, whether it leads to forgiveness or not, you have to feel better. We shouldn't make people feel guilty on top of being betrayed or damaged if they don't forgive. There are many, many routes to resolution. Each is subjective.
John, what next for you, do you think? What are you aiming for now? What are you hoping for in terms of yourself?
The one thing that comes out of all this, though, is everybody talks about the truth. And in my brain, my logic says I've not had the truth. And it drives me mad that I don't really know what happened. And one of the reasons I wanted to go to visit Kelly in the prison was I desperately wanted her to tell me what had actually happened. I couldn't ask her that. I just hoped she would.
Her sentence is coming up for review in September. How would you feel about her being released now, do you think?
if they decide to let her out, they know more about it than I do. If they decide to let her out, they've got to be right. I have to accept it.
Karen?
As long as she is not a danger to the community, I don't have a problem. I hope that she can go out and lead a productive life and give something back to the community.
Tao, you and Mark were best mates, really best mates, before the accident. Are you still best mates? Or has the relationship changed?
Oh, it's changed a lot, of course. We obviously don't drink and carry on the way that we used to, but we're still as close as ever, but just on a different level. Like we're both grown up. We've got different paths and that sort of thing now. So it's a bit different, but you know, we're still close as we can be.
Tao, how would you describe the relationship now?
I'd say it's stronger, if anything. Like, we've been through something that not many other people have been through and come out stronger. Like, he's going to be a part of my life forever now. But we've never met each other before. So, still best mates.
Thank you so much for joining us telling your story. Thank you too very much, Karen and John. Really appreciate you joining us. And thank you, everybody else. It's been a very interesting discussion. We do have to wrap it up here now, but you can keep talking online. Go to our website, Twitter or Insight's Facebook page.
Next week on Insight, an unexpected dependence. When do prescription drugs cross the line from treatment to addiction?
We'll be back next week. Stay tuned for Dateline and World News. Terrific. Thank you very much. Thank you so much.